Let's all stand. Let's all work this out. Some of you still got that turkey going from Thanksgiving. Let's clap our hands, maybe work off some of that leftovers. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Singing, oh, you are my vision, my Lord. Singing, oh, you are my wisdom, my Lord. Be thou my wisdom and thou my true word. I ever with thee and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father and I thy true Son. No ruler of all. Sing it, oh.
Seated. Good morning. It's great to see you today and to be with you and to share God's word and to celebrate Christ in this place. And Thanksgiving this week reminded me of a situation that happened a couple of years ago, and I've told the church about it, but I just want to just remind you again really what Thanksgiving is all about. I received an email from a group of atheists that meet once a month. This happened a couple of years ago, and they invited me to come to their group and to have a dialogue. They said, we don't want you to try to proselytize us, and we're not going to try to proselytize you. And I said, well, that's good. I appreciate you not trying to do that. But we had a great conversation. It was challenging. It was about 12 individuals that met. My son-in-law, Kurt, went with me as well, and we shared with them, and a lot of their questions were centered around, why is there suffering? If God is good, why is there suffering? Why is there evil in the world today? And so we answered those questions, and you know, most all of them, their reason for being atheist was not for an intellectual reason, but was because of an emotional reason. They had experienced pain in their life, and they had a hard time understanding that pain and getting that perspective. And so at the end of the conversation, I said, you know, you've asked us a lot of questions, particularly about why is there evil. But I want to ask you, how do you explain the good that is here? How do you explain the blessings of your life? And they just looked at me. And Thanksgiving reminds me that I have somebody that I can say thank you. I have a God that I worship who I can say thank you for all the good that you've given me, the blessings of this life, and which I don't deserve, especially that of salvation, which we'll talk about in a few moments. So we come today to say thank you to God. We come today to celebrate Him. And every day ought to be that way for us as believers, as followers of Christ. For those who are guests, we especially thank you for being with us today. And we ask that you take a card in the seat in front of you. That Connect card, if you'll fill that out and place that in the offering plate as your gift to us later in the service, we would appreciate you doing that. And also, we have men praying through the service right now. And you can use that same card to write down our prayer request. We'll collect those in a few moments. Those men will pray over those cards. I'll pray over them tomorrow morning. And again, thank you for the privilege of allowing me to do that, allowing our men to pray for you. But right now, let's stand and let's greet those who are near us, especially our guests.
Here's what's going on around Linwood. Christmas food basket donations are still going on. These donations go to help families in need during the Christmas season. You can decide what items you would like to donate by choosing the appropriate ornament on the Christmas tree in the foyer. Donations are due by December 4th. Our church will celebrate parent-child dedication on Sunday, December 11th during the morning worship service. This is the first step in our milestone strategy. If you are the parent of a young child and would like to participate in this meaningful ceremony, please stop by the preschool check-in area or contact Kevin Coffey by calling the church office to learn more about the Milestone 1 seminar in parent-child dedication. We're still collecting old family Christmas photos to use during a song in our Christmas program. If you have any family photos you'd like to share, feel free to drop them by the church office by this Wednesday, November 30th. This year's Christmas program entitled Christmas Through the Ages will be on Sunday evening, December 11th. We encourage you to join us for a very special night. Here's a preview.
To the casual observer, history appears like random incidents. No thread, no system, no line of connection running through it. One course of events is seen here and another there. Kingdoms rise on the stage one after another, become great and powerful, and then pass away and are forgotten. Yet all is not a chaos. If we have our eyes on God, history takes an altogether different view. That's the theme for our very own Christmas concert, Christmas Through the Ages. Sunday evening, December 11th at 5:30, we'll take a journey with music and images through time. Old and new songs will blend, and we'll hear and see stories of how God has always had a redemptive plan for His creation, and how He continues to invite us all to worship as the shepherds and angels did those many years ago on that very first Christmas night. So invite your friends and family, as it promises to be a very special evening celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior. Linwood Baptist Church presents Christmas Through the Ages. Don't miss it.
Also, just a quick reminder, there will be no evening service tonight. As always, for more information on these announcements and much more, log on to linwoodbc.org. And if you're a guest with us this morning, please remember to stop by the guest services desk out in the foyer for your free gift. And welcome to Linwood.
This morning I have the privilege of introducing to you Kathy Clippard. Kathy is involved in a very important ministry in our church, and we wanted to highlight that this morning. Let's welcome Kathy Clippard, all right? All right, Kathy, why don't you tell us about Christian Activity Center, exactly what kind of ministry that is?
Okay, the Christian Activity Center is located in East St. Louis, across the river. You can stand there and see the arch from the Christian Activity Center. But it is an after-school, faith-based organization that serves, I want to say, close to 300 to 400 children to teenagers in East St. Louis.
All right. And tell us the impact that ministry has had in East St. Louis.
Well, in the United States, there's a 1 in 250 chance of becoming a victim of violent crime. But in East St. Louis, it's 1 in 28 chances. So it's a really scary place to grow up. The children see a lot of crime through their families and through their friends. And the CAC provides a safe place. The children there in the city, there's a 2.0 grade point average. But the children that attend the CAC have a 3.1 grade point average that they have helped through tutoring and support through the center.
All right. And how are we involved with the Christian Activity Center?
Well, we partner with the CAC during Christmas, and we do Adopt a Child, where we come along with the families that participate at the CAC, and we are able to adopt a child for Christmas, and because some of the families really struggle, and those children would not receive any type of Christmas. Yeah. So we, as a church, partner with them and receive children that we adopt and help those families.
Yeah. So where do we stand with helping those families? I mean, do you have all those out, or do you need more help?
I have 11 that need to be adopted, and the presents are due by next Sunday.
Okay.
So we have 50 children that we're trying to help.
All
so
right.
Just 11 left.
Yeah. One of the things about Christmas with our kids there is it really is a ministry to the parents. It's not just to the children, because what we do is we deliver the presents and we leave and we let the parents have Christmas with their children. So it's not about us. It's not, you know, the kids don't really know who it is that's helping them, but the parents are able to have a great Christmas. And God gets the glory for that, and God sees, you know, our commitment to serve. We don't need to be in the limelight in that ministry, and it's a real blessing to be a part of that. How is being involved, and there are other things that happen, because a lot of these families, we get connected to them, and families in our church begin a long-term ministry with some of the kids and their families, but how has it impacted your life, Kathy?
Well, I have flown across the world and served on mission trips and have seen children in need, but you can drive an hour and a half and see children in need. Yeah. And it's wonderful to come and see a center that's providing help for those children and for their parents. And I have a heart for children, and to see God working with the adults that are volunteers there, it's been very impactful.
Yeah.
And makes me want to help them.
Yeah, amen. After the service, Kathy will be in the foyer if you would like to partner during Christmas and help one of these families. So you'll see her right afterward. Thank you so much, Kathy, for sharing with us. All right.
There is no life. There is no life without you. You have all that we need. Where you are, every fear is broken. In the dark must flee. Closer and closer, we want to know you. Reaching out, hearing your presence. We want to go deeper in your life. We come alive. come running in you. We find belonging. Your love is all that can satisfy. To you, we will come running in you. We find belonging. Your love is all that can satisfy.
Is my heart, Lord. Your glory is so beautiful. I fall into my knees in awe, and the heartbeat of my life is to worship in your light. Your glory is so beautiful. Your glory is so beautiful. Thank you.
humble ourselves before you this morning to acknowledge that you are a good God. Out of your grace and mercy, you have provided for us an opportunity to have a relationship with you through Jesus Christ, to know that our sin can be forgiven, to know that we have peace with you and peace with others, peace in our hearts. Father, I pray that you'll help me this morning as I share your truth. Thank you for preparing my heart. And Lord, that your Spirit will open our hearts and our minds to receive your truth. And Lord, that we'll be willing to take the step of faith and obedience that you desire for us to take this morning. God, I know there are many needs represented in this room this morning. And Father, I know that you love each person that's here, and you desire to help them at the point of their need. So may you do that now, the power of your Spirit and the power of your Word. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. For those who are guests with us today, I am concluding a series of messages called Share. We're learning about sharing our faith. And we began by learning what we're to do, and that is the Great Commission. We're to make disciples. Making disciples begins by sharing our faith, leading people to saving faith in Christ, and then helping them grow and mature into committed followers of Jesus Christ. Then we took a few weeks and learned about what we're to say. We really answered the question, what is the gospel? If somebody were to ask you, I hear this word gospel, what is that? I hear this word good news, what is that? And sharing that with them. And then, about 3 weeks ago, I role-played sharing our faith. And we talked about telling your story, that every person who's a follower of Christ has a story, that you may not be proficient in your understanding of God's Word or theological matters, but if you're a follower of Christ, you've been saved by the grace of God, and you have a story to tell. And so we talked about how to share our story, how to tell others what God has done in our lives. Now, when it comes to the gospel, and answering that question, what is the gospel, we looked in Romans chapters 1 through 4, and there are four basic questions that Paul is asking. First of all, who made us and to whom are we accountable? Secondly, are we in trouble? In other words, what's the problem and am I in trouble? And what's going to happen to me? Third, we talked about how God solved that problem and how God saved us from that problem. And then the fourth question that Paul answers is, how can you and I, right now, right here in this place, get in on that salvation? How can my problem be solved? And so out of that, we learned that there are four basic words that we use as somewhat of an outline to follow in sharing our faith. Repeat after me. First word is God. God, man, Christ, response, kingdom. All right? So that's how we let it flow. In other words, God created us. We are made by Him. And because of that, my life has meaning, my life has value, and that I'm here for a reason. But it also means because God has made me, I'm accountable to Him. I have to answer to Him for the decisions that I've made in life, for the things that I say and the things that I do. And because of that, then, man has chosen to rebel against God, and that's called sin. Man is a sinner. All men have sin, and that we're going to be judged according to our sin. Now, for those who become a follower of Christ, we're judged today when we make that commitment. But for those who do not follow Christ, that they're going to face God's judgment in eternity, and they're going to spend eternity in a place of suffering called hell forever. All right? Now, our response, I mean, the way God solved that problem is through Jesus Christ. God promised that He was going to establish a kingdom. Not so much an earthly kingdom, but a kingdom of the heart. And that God desires to reign. It's a redemptive king that we have who wants to reign and rule in a man's heart. And He promised this kingdom. He promised it to David. And He said there would be a messianic king who would reign on that throne forever. But that king came, Jesus Christ, and He's also a suffering king. Excuse me. And that He would die on the cross. And the reason that He did that is to take care of our sin problem. He satisfied God's wrath against sin, and He took our place. In other words, that He was the perfect God-man. He was fully God and fully man. He could be the perfect sacrifice, and he could represent man. He could represent you as man to take the penalty for your sin. But he was also the risen king, that he rose from the dead. He reigns today, and that verified the fact that he did overcome sin and death, and that he conquered Satan, and that he lives today and wants to live in our hearts. Our response to that is that we have to believe by faith and repentance. I have to believe that of who Jesus is and what he did on the cross, but it's not just believing a set of facts about Jesus. It's not a feel-good story whenever we hear the story of Christ. It means that I must repent. I must change directions. Instead of going my way, I turn at the point of conversion, at the point of giving my life to Christ, and I begin to follow him with my life. And then I begin to learn to live in his kingdom. I'm a citizen of the kingdom of God, and I'm learning how to let him have his way in my life. Let him reign in my heart, living in the kingdom of God. And so we talk through, those are the basic elements of how a person understands the gospel message. Now, again, I want to encourage you to go to YouTube, just Google Linwood on YouTube or on the bar search bar. And 3 weeks ago today, I shared that in a more fluid way, in a conversational way with somebody here on the platform. And in that way, you'll have an idea of how to share the faith. But listen, even with all that, it's still hard to share our faith, isn't it? Now, I want to help you today, because sharing our faith is very hard to do, and most of the time, we're afraid of being rejected. I want you to remember this. Most people have not rejected Jesus Christ. They've rejected a caricature of Jesus Christ. They've not rejected Christ because they really haven't heard about Jesus Christ. They see Jesus through churchianity, and they have a false understanding of what it's really all about. And so that's why it's important that we share what the facts are concerning Jesus Christ. They have a skewed understanding, and so that gives me encouragement, should give you encouragement, to know that most people really don't understand the message of the Bible, the message of Jesus Christ. So with that, sharing, if you really want to learn how to share, it begins by praying. It begins by praying, and we're going to learn today a tool that you can use to help with that first step of overcoming your fear of sharing the gospel. If you will, open your Bibles to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John 5. Just a few brief verses that we're going to read this morning, because I want to help you. Listen, I want to help you lead your family and your friends to faith in Jesus Christ. And that person that you may encounter, you don't even know, but you're going to be equipped to share the gospel with them. But I will give you a tool today that's going to really help you, and you'll be amazed of what God will start doing in your life as a witness if you begin to pray specifically for those who need to come to faith in Jesus Christ. Now notice what John writes in 1 John 5:14. Now this is the confidence that we have before him. Whenever we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears whatever we ask, we know that we have what we have asked for him, from him. Several things that I want us to note this morning. First of all, we must pray according to God's will. We must pray according to God's will. Thank you. Notice he says that we are to pray according to his will. It is God's, the question is it God's will for our family and friends to be saved? What is his will concerning that? Let me give you some help. 1 Timothy 2, verse 3. This is good, and it pleases God our Savior, who wants everyone to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Peter writes in 2 Peter 3, the Lord does not delay his promise, as some understand delay, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. So here we find that God wants our family and friends to be saved. Now, I'm not going to get into the theological diversity concerning God's will, His sovereign will, and man's response in evangelism. Here's what I know, that God has commanded each believer to be a witness for Christ, to share the gospel with others. And we know that I can't save a person. You can't save a person. That's the work of God, the work of the Holy Spirit. But all I'm responsible to do is to be a witness for Christ, and I let God do the rest. But I do know that He wants me to witness to everyone. He wants me to witness to my family and friends. And the Bible is here in these two verses that He wants everyone to be saved. As I can't get beyond that as far as being absolutely sure how it all works. I just know that it works. Spurgeon said that when we look at evangelism and God's sovereignty, they run on parallel tracks. God's sovereign will and evangelism, man's response to the gospel message. They intersect at some point. How? We don't really know how all that happens, but we know that it does because we've all come to understand faith in Christ Jesus. My job is to be a witness for Christ. Now, how do we pray according to God's will for unbelievers? Let me give you a few helpful ideas. First of all, you need to pray with the right approach. We need to pray that they'll be set free. They're bound, that they'll be loosed from the burden that they have from the enemy. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. But if in fact our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. Regarding them, the God of this age has blinded the minds of the unbelievers, so they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Paul said in 2 Timothy 2, the Lord's slave must not, or servant, must not quarrel, but must be gentle to everyone, able to teach and patient, instructing his opponents with gentleness. Perhaps God will grant them repentance to know the truth. Then they may come to their senses and escape the devil's trap, having been captured by him to do his will. So as I approach somebody, I need to understand who I'm talking to. I'm talking to somebody who's been blinded by the enemy, who is living under the kingdom of the enemy, and they're not able to understand what we've come to understand. So it may be somebody in our family who is argumentative. It may be somebody who's belligerent. It may be somebody who refuses to talk to you. They just don't want to have any kind of conversation. But you need to be reminded that I can't get mad at them. That's not the right approach. But I have to be patient, and I have to be praying of concerning their eternal state and where they are as far as being blinded by the enemy. Now, secondly, we need to pray with the right aim. We need to pray against our adversary, against the devil, not against our loved ones. Our target is not the sinner, but it's Satan himself. Acts 16, verse 18. Now, here's a woman who was creating some problem for Paul. And as they were sharing the gospel. And he says this, she did this for many days, but Paul was greatly aggravated and turning to the Spirit said, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her, and it came out right away. Where was his aggravation directed? Was it to her? No, it was to Satan. He knew who the enemy was. He knew that she was a captive of the enemy. And so whenever we're dealing with somebody who doesn't know Christ, we need to make sure our aim is right in who we're praying against. We're praying against the enemy and know that he is the target. We also need to pray with the right authority, praying in the name of Jesus and in his victory. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, we find Paul writing these words. 2 Corinthians 10 verse 3. For although we are walking in the flesh, that means we're humans here, we do not wage war in a fleshly way, since the weapons of our warfare are not fleshly, but are powerful through God for the demolition of strongholds. We demolish arguments and every high-minded thing that is raised up against the knowledge of God, taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. Let me ask you this. Have you ever found yourself and you ask yourself, why do I think that? Why do I respond that way? And you find that there are thoughts that are controlling you. negative thoughts, critical thoughts, evil thoughts, whatever it may be. And you don't understand why you're reacting and responding the way that you do. Maybe somebody's confronted you about that. Why did you say that? Why do you always say that? Why do you always react that way? And here Paul is encouraging us to take the thought captive unto the obedience of Christ so that we can demolish strongholds that have developed in our lives. And as we're praying as intercessors for others, we're doing the same thing. We're praying for that victory and with that right authority. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14, notice. Now since the children have flesh and blood in common, he, that is Jesus, also shared in these. We're human, he became human, he became flesh and blood. So that through his death, he might destroy the one holding the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who were held in slavery all their lives by the fear of death. 1 John 3:8. The Son of God was revealed for this purpose to destroy the devil's works. And then John 16:33, Jesus said, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. You will have suffering in this world. Be courageous. I have conquered the world. Now, we need to understand that Jesus has already overcome the enemy. And so the enemy doesn't have to have the last say in a person's life, family or friend, who doesn't know Christ. That Christ has given us the victory to pray according to his will that they be saved. We have the right to pray that way. We have the authority, we have the power to pray in that way and to believe that God can save a person who is so far from God we think he could never be saved, but he can be saved. So God desires that our family and friends know Christ, and we pray according to God's will. We pray in that way. Notice, secondly, not only do we pray according to God's will, but we must pray with a pure heart. Notice verse 15. He says, we pray according to his will if we know that he hears. Do you believe that he hears? When you pray, do you really believe that God hears you? Well, there may be times that God doesn't hear you. Really, that's not accurate. He hears us. He may not respond the way that we want him to respond. And we need to know why that is true. Maybe the prayer is delayed. But maybe there are things going on in your life that are hindering God's prayers being effective in your life. Let me give you some reasons why God may not be responding to your prayers. First of all, there may be unconfessed sin. Psalm 66:18. If I had been aware of malice in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. Again, the Lord hears what we say. He can't respond if I'm aware of malice in my heart, of sin in my heart. Isaiah 59. Indeed, the Lord's hand is not too short to save. Well, that's a great, great verse. The Lord's hand is not too short to save, and his ear is not too deaf to hear. But your iniquities have built barriers between you and your God, and your sins have made him hide his face from you so that he does not listen. Now, what you need to do is you need to have a gut check this afternoon. You need to get along with God. You may be praying for somebody to be saved in your family or somebody you work with or whoever. Or you may be praying about something else. And you just don't feel that the prayers are working. But I've been there. I am there. Sometimes I'm praying even now and I'm thinking, God, you know, why? What's going on here? But what you need to do is just go to the Lord and say, Lord, here's some sin that I know is unconfessed. Confession means I just agree with God. God's convicted me. I confess that to him. Yes, I have sinned. And thank him for his forgiveness. And I also pray, God, if I'm not aware of sin that's creating a problem, then make me aware of that sin. Now get ready if you pray that. Because he'll make you aware that there's sin in the camp. You may think it's buried under the tent, but God will reveal it. And God, and he does that because he loves you. And so I ask him, God, there's too much at stake for my family member, my friend, not to be saved. So we don't want to hide that sin in our hearts. We want to confess that sin so that it's not a hindrance to God doing what he wants to accomplish. Another reason may be because of an unyielded spirit, or it may be because of selfishness. James 4:3, you ask and don't receive because you ask wrongly, so that you may spend it on your desires for pleasure. And so it's selfishness. I want my friend to be saved so I can tell everybody what a great person I am, that I led this family member to be saved, or that I'm receiving the glory instead of God receiving the glory. But it's about me rather than about God. Salvation is about God. God uses us as a tool. We're just the instrument. But if you look at the Apostle Paul as he was a witness for Christ, constantly giving God glory for the work that God was doing. And that's the attitude of the heart that we must have, is that God, it may not be me who leads them to Christ, but bring somebody across their path, Lord, that will lead them to saving faith in Christ. Let somebody work with them or become a friend to them, or they'll encounter somebody on an elevator or wherever it may be. It doesn't have to be about us. Third, one of the reasons that God might not be able to respond to your prayer is because of an unforgiving spirit. Now, I need an hour for this. An unforgiving spirit. Mark 11, Jesus said, and whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, so that your Father in heaven will also forgive you your wrongdoing. Let's make it real practical. 1 Peter chapter 3. Husbands, in the same way, live with your wives with understanding of their weaker nature, yet showing them honor as co-heirs of the grace of life. Now notice, so that your prayers will not be hindered. Men, if there's something not right at home, your prayers don't get past the roof of the ceiling. And the opposite is true, ladies. And really, if I'm at odds at anyone, if I have an unforgiving spirit toward anyone, it affects my prayer life. God says, whoa, before you do anything else as it relates to me as an act of worship, you stop and you make that thing right. At least make the attempt to make it right. And then I know that I am free. There's nothing holding me, it's nothing binding me or binding my prayers as I pray to God for those who need to be saved. And then another reason that God may not be answering my prayers is because of an unbelieving heart. An unbelieving heart. What we find in James chapter 1, verse 5. Now, if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives to all generously and without criticizing, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith without doubting. For the doubter is like the surging sea driven and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. So how we pray is critical. We need to make sure that we're praying with a pure heart. Not a perfect heart. You see, there's a difference between being perfect and pure. I'm not going to be perfect. But I can pray with a pure heart in that my motive, my attitude, that I am right with God. And even when I sin, God makes it possible for me to still have a pure heart. Amen? That I can still be right with God. As Paul said, I'm able to stand holy and blameless before him. Not because of the good in me, but because of the grace of God who has forgiven me of all my sin, so that it doesn't affect my prayer life when I'm praying for those who need to be saved. Also, we need to pray with a burden. We need to pray with a burden. When we ask, we must ask with a burden. We can't come lightly when we're praying for somebody who needs to be saved. Now, let me share with you some ways that you can pray with a burden, all right? First of all, pray, just begin this way. Pray for the masses. Find a large group of people and walk among them and begin to pray for them. Not out loud, not with your eyes closed. Just pray. God, help me see them as you see them. God, help me feel the way you feel for them. Now, how does the Lord feel for those who are not saved. Matthew 9, verse 36. When he saw the crowds, he felt compassion for them because they were weary and worn out like sheep without a shepherd. What did Jesus say on the cross? Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. We see people who are hurting, who are burdened. That's what Jesus saw. People who are being abused by the religious leaders. That's the context of that verse. And there are people who are being abused by other people, by religion, by the enemy. And they're hurting, they're struggling. And do we see the masses the way Jesus sees them? Let me ask you this. When you walked into this room this morning with this mass that's here, was there any concern for the crowd that's here? Did anybody pray for this crowd? Did anybody pray for the person next to you? God, I wonder if that man, that woman knows Christ. Lord, I lift them up to you right now. Maybe I can be an instrument of your saving grace to them. When we walk into school, young people, do you sit down in that classroom and you see the mass of that crowd in that classroom? God, help me see them as you see them. Help me feel for them like you feel for them. Think about what's going on in their life and where they are. You know, so often I'll see somebody and I'll just say to myself, boy, they are not happy. That's a sad person. They may not say anything. They may not do anything. But God will put that in your spirit. And you begin to pray for them right there. They may say something. They may do something. It may even irritate you, but it's usually because something's going on in their life. It's hurting. Where you work. The crowd that's at work. That employer, that employee, those around you, your peers. Do you really understand what's going on in their lives? We need to pray with a burden. And I promise you, when you begin to see people like that and pray for people with a burden because of the state that they're in, God is going to give you opportunities to share the gospel. They're going to come to you. They're going to ask questions. They're going to say something, and you're going to be able to initiate a conversation, steer the conversation to the gospel, because God's put it in your heart, and God's put it on their heart as well. Another way that you can pray with a burden is find a Christian with a burning heart for unbelievers. Find somebody in this church that you know has a hot heart for God and for unbelievers, and begin to pray for those who are lost. Pray for your family and friends specifically, and get around them and listen to them pray. Listen to their burden, and God will increase your burden and increase your prayer life. Moses met with God outside the camp in the wilderness. Exodus 33:11 says this, "The Lord spoke with Moses face to face, just as a man speaks with his friend. Then Moses would return to the camp, but his assistant, the young man Joshua, son of Nun, would not leave the inside of the tent." You see what happened? When God and Moses were praying, there was a young man in the corner of the room who saw it all happen and heard it all happen and prayed. And when Moses left, Joshua was still praying. What a great ministry that Moses had with Joshua to develop his prayer life and for Joshua to be able to see this is how you do it. This is how you pray. Can you just think about it? Think about it in heaven. Joshua, what really went on when Moses and God met face to face? And so Joshua was able to learn from that. So get with somebody who is strong in their prayer life and who will help you develop that burden to pray for others. Also, develop a global vision in your prayer life. We pray for our family and friends, but we need to pray beyond that. We need to pray for the world. Billions of people who don't know Christ as Lord and Savior. This time of the year, during the Christmas season, we highlight that. And over the next several weeks, you're going to be seeing and hearing more about how we're impacting the world. Last Sunday, our Mission Sunday, Go 17, of how we're able to take the gospel to faraway places. But listen, let me tell you, it begins by what happens right here in this place, and it begins by praying. We need to be praying for more soul winners. That's how you pray with a burden. What did Jesus say? Matthew 9:38, therefore pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest. You may not be one who shares the gospel much, but maybe God has convicted you to pray for laborers to go out. Pray for people to go out and share the gospel. You know what will happen? You'll find yourself going. You'll find yourself out there praying and sharing as well. And also, prayerfully study the gospels. You'll see the heart of Jesus for others. And listen, when you read the gospels, it's all about relationships. It's all about relationships. And listen, relationships are the key to life. Bad relationships create bad marriages, bad homes, divided churches, chaotic governments and nations. Good relationships creates a good marriage, a good home with your children, a good place at work, a good working environment, a good relationship with other nations. So it's all key. And there are only two key relationships you need to worry about. One that is vertical and one that's horizontal. Getting it right with God and getting it right with others. Oscar Thompson was a seminary professor at Southwestern Baptist Seminary in Fort Worth. And he died early in his life from cancer. But he wrote a book called Concentric Circles of Concern. And he talked about this idea of relationships and where do we start? Well, he says, first of all, if you just take a small circle and then build concentric circles around that, the first one is self. Am I right with God? And I want to ask you, are you right with God? Have you come to that place in your life that you've said yes to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? I shared the gospel just a few moments ago. What's been your response? To say no? You're thinking about it? Well, if you're still thinking about it, you've in essence said no. So maybe today God is saying to you, I love you and I want to have a relationship with you and I want to forgive you of your sin, but you have to respond by faith and repentance, turning to Christ, knowing that it's not my righteousness that can get me into heaven, but it's the righteousness of Christ. And so I trust in His righteousness, not my own, and begin to follow Him as my Lord and Savior. In a few moments, I'm going to give an opportunity for you to respond, to accept the invitation of Christ, to trust Him as your Lord and Savior, and to begin to follow Him with your life. It begins with self. Then it moves to our immediate family. Who in your closest circle, your immediate family, who doesn't know Christ? Then those are key relationships that God's put into your life to witness to them. Then outside of my family, relatives. My immediate family, that is. Who are the relatives that need to know Christ? Maybe a cousin. It may be an aunt. It may be a grandmother or whoever who doesn't know the Lord, and begin to share with them and to see a ripple effect in generations of coming to know Christ. My mother and my father both broke the cycle of dysfunction in their families when they came to know Christ as their Lord and Savior. And to see the ripple effect of that transformation in individuals who married each other, and now to see that generations, great-grandchildren now, who are coming onto the scene. All their children and all their grandchildren, 15, have come to know Christ as their Lord and Savior. That's only by the grace of God. But that's what the gospel can change families, can change generations. And so don't give up on your family. Keep praying for your family. And then we go to those who are close friends. That's the next concentric circle. Those who we know who are friends of ours who don't know Christ. And sometimes those friendships may last for years, but you keep living out your faith and keep sharing your faith. Then to neighbors. Or maybe business associates who need Christ. Are you praying for your neighbors? Are you praying for those you're working with? And then acquaintances that you may know in certain organizations, and you begin to develop relationships with them. And then the person X out there, as Oscar calls him, the guy that just intersects your life at some point. You see, so often we're worried about witnessing to that guy who we don't even know. Really, that's the easiest person to witness to, isn't it? It's very easy for me to go to Honduras or to go to Africa or to go to Europe and share the gospel with somebody I don't know. But if it's my spouse, if it's my child, if it's my parent, it makes it hard. And so we begin to praying and begin to moving in those relationships that God has given us. So we pray with a burden. Finally, we must pray believing God's promise. The key to victory is to accept the promise that God has given in His Word. Verse 14, He hears us. He hears us. And when we come to God in prayer under these conditions, we have the assurance that God hears us and that God is at work. That's the key. Remember, though you may not see God is working, God is at work in that person's life. I'm not sure if I've shared this illustration before, but George Mueller was a great man of faith and prayer. And early in his life, he wrote down the names of five of his closest friends who did not know Christ as Lord and Savior. He began to pray for them by name. After 5 years, one was saved. After 10 years, two more were saved. After 25 years of praying, the fourth man was saved. After 52 years of praying for his fifth friend, 2 months after he died, that man came to saving faith in Jesus Christ. Now, I don't understand all that. But I do know this, God was at work through the prayers of George Mueller. And we need to realize that sharing begins by praying. And so I want to challenge you today. I want you to go home this afternoon. I want you to write down the names of your family and friends who don't know Christ. And I want you to begin to praying for them specifically. Pray for them with a burden that God would save them. And I promise you, you're going to see God work. You're going to see things happen. You're going to start having conversations you thought you would never have with that person because God has been cultivating the heart. And some it just takes longer for that to happen. And then God will do the miracle that only He can do. You may have the privilege of leading them to Christ. He may bring somebody else to lead them to faith in Christ. But God receives the glory for it all because He's the one at work. There might be somebody here this morning who would say, Pastor, I'm that person. My mom's been praying for me for a long time. My dad. My grandmother has been praying for me. You're perhaps today going to be the answer to their prayers. 5 years, 10 years, 25, 52 years. I don't know. Just hold on, I want to give you the opportunity. Your heart to Christ. Would you bow your head and close your eyes? Indeed, there might be somebody who needs to give your heart to Christ in just a moment. When we sing this next song, it's a time of response to what God has said in our hearts and what He's asking us to do. And I want to encourage you, if you need to give your heart to Christ, come. I'll be here at the front to help you. You may not know what to say or do, but I'll be able to help you. And there might be others in this room who know the Lord, you're not where you should be spiritually, and you need to ask God to help you get back on the right path. Or maybe you're a follower of Christ and God has convicted you that there are things in your life that are hindering you from having God respond to your prayers. And so you just deal with that right now in these few moments. Just confess that to the Lord, accept His forgiveness, and leave it right here. And begin to pray and pray with power. Maybe God's put somebody on your heart, even now in this place. Begin praying during this time of response for them. Go home this afternoon and write down those names. Maybe God's leading somebody to come be a part of our church family here. A church that desires to see people come to know Christ. whether it's here in this area or anywhere in this world where God sends us, be part of a church that's committed to helping people grow in their faith. You and your family, we invite you to come. Or maybe you should come and talk with somebody, or come and pray here at the altar. Father, thank you for the power of your word, for its truth. And Lord, for the reality of our faith, knowing that you desire for us to share our faith, but Lord, help us to begin by praying. And as the disciples asked the Lord Jesus, Father, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray. And the best way is to just start praying. God, I pray you'll help us pray more effectively. Pray with a burden, pray with power, pray with a pure heart. Pray according to your will, Father, that others may come into your kingdom. Help these who need to make commitments now, in Christ's name. Amen. Would you quietly stand right now? We're going to have a time of response while we sing this next song. As God speaks to your heart, you come.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never.
Time to give your Go 17 card. You
received that in the mail. You're praying about what you're giving toward missions, which is above and beyond our tithes and normal offerings. And so if God is leading you to do that, you'll place that card in the offering plate and we can bring it next week. But men, you come. Let's have a word of prayer. Mike, you come and lead us as we give to the Lord.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the message that we've heard this morning. And Lord, I pray that you would open our eyes to the spiritual battles that are taking place right now for the souls of those around us. Lord, I pray that we would be men and women of prayer, that you would use those prayers to make people who might be spiritually dead alive in your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, right now as we give back to you, Lord, I pray that you would bless it, that you would use it to meet physical and spiritual needs of those in this town and those around the world, all for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. thank God redeemed.
That's a great note, great message and song to end the whole series. You're redeemed. You've been bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank God for that. Tonight we'll not have any activities, no services, as you heard earlier in the announcements. We'll make you aware of that to remind you. But we've had several deaths in our church family over the holidays time, so I want to make sure you're aware of these. Some you may know. First of all, Junior Rayburn's mother passed away recently, and I believe it was Thursday morning. And the visitation will be from 10 to 11 in advance at the funeral home, and then the service is going to be at the funeral home as well, I believe. And that'll be on Wednesday. Then Susie Smith's mother, she went home to be with the Lord. That service will be December the 3rd. Visitation from 9 to 11, services at 11 at St. Andrew's. Cheryl Stillwell's father went home to be with the Lord. That service was this past week. Don Mayfield's brother unexpectedly passed away. And that service is going to be tomorrow at 2 o'clock. And that'll be at the Little Whitewater Baptist Church there in Patton. The visitation is this afternoon from 4 to 8 at Wiley Funeral Home in Patton. And another word of praise, if you've been kind of watching and keeping up, that Jeff and Winnie Moran is there in Brazil. They're going through a process of adopting two children, siblings, brother and sister. That all got approved. They're official. They are now Morans, and they're going to be coming back to the States about the first week of December. So we're very excited and praise God for that. And we'll be ready to love on them, right, when they get here. Then on a personal note, Karen and I, on Monday, received word Karen's mom got put back in the hospital and been in the ICU for a period of time, and so we rushed over. And if y'all just pray, she's still in the hospital. Karen's going to be there for another week probably. And she just wanted you to know and thank you for the prayers that you've been offering for her and for her family. So many of you, too, have needs that we know. And that's the one thing about the beauty of the body of Christ is that we can lift each other up in prayer, encourage one another, and that's part of who we are. We thank the Lord for that. Mark, thank you. I want to introduce to you Travis. Travis, won't you come and stand here with me if you would, if you don't mind. This is Travis Davey, and Travis came this morning, and he said, I've come to give my heart to Christ. He's not done that. He wants to do so this morning. Did that with Mark. And Travis, man, we're excited for you, proud of you for making this commitment to Christ. It's life-changing. Now it's learning what it means to be a follower of Christ, and that's a process, okay? We all are still in that process. Nobody's arrived, and we have our good days and bad days, and so don't be discouraged at some of those things that might happen, but there's a great life, a great future that God has for you. And if you rejoice in the commitment that he's made today, would you join me by saying amen? Those who are guests, if I've not met you personally, we'd love to do so out of the foyer after service. And I pray God will give you a great week as you begin praying for those who don't know Christ and watch for those opportunities to open up to share the gospel. Amen. God bless you.